Okay, hello everyone. Let's start to the talk. My name is Javier. I work as a computer engineer and storage engineer in Igalia. I'm also part of the cloud and virtualization team in the company. And I contribute code upstream since 2015 in the Rados Gateway S3 layer. In this talk, in this presentation, I'm going to talk about two related topics. The first one is the value of contributing new features and improvements in the Rados Gateway S3 layer. I will include some of my contributions in these last years. And the second topic will be my way to go upstream. To frame the talk, we need to understand how Amazon S3 works it and how it is working now. Amazon S3 was released in 2006. It was designed to be a very simple service. Through an S3 API, developers can store, retrieve, list objects in a kind of logical containers called buckets. To reference this object, you only need the name of the object, the name of the bucket, and one name of the AWS region holding the data. Being a really simple service was disruptive in 2006 because it provides to developers a really easy integration and companies a low cost to have a very reliable and robust distributed system at the global scale. My first contact with Amazon S3 was in 2008. At that moment, company called Little, a company located in Boston, was exploring a new notebook concept called webbooks. These webbooks or devices were based on web interfaces and cards that would be more intuitive and easy for non-technical persons. I work in the update systems in this project. The updates and images of these devices were stored in Amazon S3. And I was really surprised because the service at that moment proved to be very reliable and robust. I realized Amazon S3 provides to electronic consumer companies a very easy way to have update their devices at the global scale, and it was shocking for me. But that vision is incomplete nowadays. Amazon continues evolving the API, the specification, including plenty of new features. All these features are related to storage management mainly, and they provide added value for users over the original functionality. To get an idea about the complexity of the API, you can have a look at the official documentation size. I think nobody can say Amazon S3 is simple anymore. The value chain of the Amazon S3 appeared in this slide. Although it mentioned the storage management on S3, I think every feature in the API could fit any box in this picture. Amazon understands the value chains in a very simple way. It's all about identifying, tagging objects or resources, using usage classes, applying a data lifecycle, and finally delivering to final customers. It is divided into in two parts. On the top, it's called Organize, Monitor, Analyze, and Act. And the bottom, a transversal stage called Security Management. The previous slide is an abstract way to understand the value chain. So I include this example. This is a video transcoding services, and you can see three layers, really. First layer to ingest data, server layer processing data, and the last layer, the way how things get delivered to final customers. The value chains map to every stage perfectly. The previous slide is the value chain in detail. So in a more compact form, you can see them in the references architectures. And you see always the same pattern, data in, data out, and data in. If Amazon S3 is so cool, because why users and companies are adopting another solutions, and why users and companies are adopting Rados Way S3. In my experience, there are four major reasons. Costs, flexibility, security and privacy, and geopolitics. At some point, if you use Rados Way and Rados Gateway, the solutions become more cost effective than using Amazon S3. Being an open source product bring flexibility to users and projects at the end. The public companies are not the perfect place to host sensitive data. For companies subject to compliance regulations. And at the end, if you are a government or you are a company working with a government, it's possible you need your own cloud. In these cases, Rados Gateway S3 fits really good. In these years, I have worked with three different kinds of users and companies. Base storage consumers, cheap and massive storage consumers, and online storage providers. Base storage consumers. This kind of users and companies are interested in S3 compatibility and feature coverage only. They are not interested to invest in new features in Rados Gateway. They are not interested to bring new things. They use Rados Gateway as a simple Amazon S3 clone. So they are they try to catch up with the state of the art of the service. As an example, I added the BOTO2 compatibility feature. People think about being compatible is about modifying offshore codes and to include hard-coded behaviors. But companies are not interested in that. They are interested to have a dynamic way to trade off, in this case, performance versus compatibility. Another example is feature coverage. Users and companies make decisions based on compatibility matrix, but if you implement along a complex feature, it evolves along the step releases. In this case, I use the example AWS before. It landed in Jewel, but it evolved along Kraken to be really robust in Luminous. The second group of users and companies are cheap and massive storage consumers. Here, the business drivers are cost and optimization. As a first example, I would like to introduce the ArchiveZone. I implemented ArchiveZone the last year. And it was shipped in Nautilus release. If you don't know, ArchiveZone is the way how you can catch all updates and modifications in every zone, but in one zone called the ArchiveZone. It works at the S3 object level, and it's a space-saving feature. The second example in this category will be Ansible. Ansible is a very popular automation tool. It was upstream in 2016. I work with the Ansible community. It was really difficult to get it in because while the implementation was really trivial, about 3 hours, getting upstream last 8 months. Exchanging mails, looking the right people, so the effort was considerable. Related to online storage providers, the third group, they are the most innovative group. The major difference with the previous group is that they have final users, so they have to provide a final developer experience, and they are interested in update documentation, examples, libraries, SDKs, and new features to be able to compete on the market. Here I include the browser-based Tableau's awesome post. Beyond the features, the most interesting part is appear here in red. To graph as an S3 HTML form and a policy. Users here are really concerned about having the right tool to support server-side features. Sometimes we think it's all about having the feature in the server side, but if you cannot use in the client side, we lost the battle. So it's really important providing that documentation. And sometimes the official SEP documentation is not the right place. In this case, they are interested to keep up the documentation in their web, blogs, wiki, and so on. The second aspects will be software developer kits, libraries, and client tooling support. I include the libcloud integration. I merged this feature in 2016. Libcloud is a Python library to use popular clouds using a unified API. The project was all about implementing two drivers, one first driver and more generic driver, providing core functionality to connect with Rados Gateway S3, and one more specific to provide, in this case, AutoScale, the company sponsoring the feature. Here, the interesting thing is about if you customize the developer experience in LibCloud, you will have to use the AutoScale driver as template to change minimal things as pricing, kind of storage, and so on. And all things will continue working without major problems. Related to new S3 features and stations, I include the requested pipe buckets. I implemented this feature in 2016. Here, when companies think about final users, they think about individual users. But in the practice, we have communities and associations working as one only entity. In the case of the requested pay bucket, the users demand to the provider a way to share costs. As the requested pay bucket was available in the specification, the only thing I have to do was catching up with the specification. Another example of a simple extension but really useful is called virtual error buckets. In this case, the customer demanded a way to track requests to non-existing resources. This abstraction lives only in the user's login, but before merging this feature, customer has to parse and aggregate all logs. And having the feature in place is really helpful for them. About my way to go upstream with news features, I think it's all about technical complexity, about handling technical complexity, business risks, and having a good communication with every parties. Parties here are companies, users, developers, maintainers, everybody. I usually use this simple script. It's a script taking 4 points, understanding the problem, coming up with a plan, implementing the plan, and verifying your results. I run this script in an open way in the community. Before going with the example, I would like to comment in this script. If you have a quick look, you can think about the difficult parties implementing the plan, the third bullet. But in my experience, the most challenging part is understanding the problem. For example, with the archive zone, the last feature shipping in Nautilus, understanding the problem was really demanding because it was born an exploratory feature. So we have a lot of meetings. I have to implement a proof of concept. We have to talk with different maintainers and just only to start the project. Having in mind this development is funding. Sometimes it's really challenging. The example introduced to show how I run the script will be the AWS before. AWS before is an S3 request authentication algorithm. It's the current one in Amazon S3. The previous one was called AWS V2. It bring to the project new benefits, and in 2015 it was a really strategic feature because Amazon was deprecating the AWS V2, and Zeb was missing the support for and the client side. In this case, AWS V4 is really specified, so. And the points understanding the problem and coming up, understanding the problem is not, that does not require a big effort. But the questions I ask myself are this. Is there a real problem? Anyone working on it? Is there a real interest in going upstream? In the case of AWS before, the only question was asking to maintainer, to Yehuda, about is anybody working on that? Can I work on that? The answer is yes, so go ahead. About researching similar options, in this case, Amazon Stream has not an available reference implementation. So you have to reverse engineer, you have to read the specification, you have to run a lot of tests. To see how things are working. It was really useful reading official client-side examples and having a look in open source. About modeling the system and breaking the problem in pieces, I always suggest starting with the architecture. In this case, the slide is a bit tricky because the blue box, should go in the execution layer because in this case you need to take control along the request. The way to break the problem for AWS version 4 was all about breaking down for authorization method. I decided going with a single chunk, multiple chunk and query string parameters because I found a balance between effort and time in that project. About prioritizing, when you prioritize, it's all about talking to customer. Customer decide what is going to go at the first place, so that the priorities were chosen by them. This is the final plan. The final plan has 3 points. All points have to ship with test cases because an algorithm, an authentication algorithm is a critical part. It goes in the main request path. So it it had to work really, really good. When you have available the plan, I always share with maintainers to see if it can work or not. The implementation, as usual, you start with a simple skeleton. You implement a specific a minimum functionality. You iterate, you share with maintainers. All things go okay. You keep the progress, you check with the customer, you progress. It's all about looping. I include this code because although the original AWS V4 algorithm evolved a lot, the original code used to map the technical complexity and business risks is intact. If you see the switch, you see several cases and one default. The business risks, the technical complexity is managed with every case. So when the customer asks for a new Rados Gateway operation, you include that a new case and you develop. If you found a blocker or something not working or you hit a problem, then you avoid with the error not implemented. The idea here is always ship. If you have an unexpected event, it's not important because you always ship. About verifying your results, the most important is implementing test cases when you think all things are working as expected, and useful logging. Useful logging is really important for me because if you want to understand the bug fixes report, the best thing is having a look on the attached logs. This is one example of the log saving variables. As you see, I use a mapping between internal variables and the logging to check easily if the algorithm is working or not. Bear in mind, the algorithm has a lot has functions, so it's really easy adding or having some issue with a simple character, and all things go wrong in that moment. About AWS specific tests, I use the S3 test project. Is the S3 test project is based on Node. It's really easy to implement new test cases because all code is perfectly factored and you can use templates. So it's really easy. Final remarks. I think a competitive S3 API responds to real market needs. I also think the value and impact of the S3 API is not well understood because users and companies think in the S3 API just a simple S3 storage interface. And they miss the opportunity to include new features to compete and bring value in their business. I think, about the users and companies, in these years, I have worked with several users and companies willing to invest in high value upstream contributions. But it's really important having a systematic and flexible process to manage unexpected events, because it's not the same working upstream just to work for fun that working in sponsored features in a sustainable way. If you want to merge new features each year, it's really important having that framework. And the end, I think new features and specific extensions are key to adopt Rados Gateway in new business context. Before ending the talk, I would like to give thanks to Mantainers and Yehuda. Yehuda was the man helping a lot and resolving a lot of doubts. And okay, thank you, Yehuda. And I think it's all. If you are interested to talk in depth about new features, or you are a company in these groups willing to invest, I will be in the floor, so feel free to approach. And thank you for attending.